Wing Commander David Farquhar was a staff officer working under the Joint Commander-in-Chief of British forces in Saudi Arabia during 1990, after the Iraqi dictatorship invaded and occupied Kuwait. He had a very important job, guarding the top-secret plans detailing how the coalition would defeat the Iraqi military. Farquhar was given a briefcase containing the plans, which included details of the fact that the coalition were deceiving the Iraqi military, that they would invade into Kuwait by sea, rather than their actual plan, which was to invade by land from the south and west. The plan was written on paper documents, as well as being contained on a laptop. Farquhar also had £1,000 in the briefcase. By December 1990, though, Farquhar was burnt out. He was under strict orders to keep the plans with him 24/7 and had to fly between Saudi Arabia, the US, and the UK for meetings while working 80 hours a week. He had apparently begun having panic attacks, needed medication for insomnia, and often felt jet-lagged. On December 17th, Farquhar and his commander travelled to London to meet with the new Prime Minister, John Major, and explain the outline of the coalition war plans. After this meeting, while in the car to RAF headquarters, Farquhar asked his driver to pull over because he wanted to look at a car in a second-hand showroom. He got out of the car, locked the briefcase and laptop in the boot, and went to look at the car with his driver. About 5 minutes later, they came back and found that the car had been broken into and the plans stolen. When he saw that they were gone, Farquhar later said that he felt the icy fingers of fear gripping me by the throat. I felt I had let myself down, my country, my commander-in-chief. The British government and military were now left with three problems. First, getting the plans back. Second, the Iraqi government getting their hands on them. Third, the American government finding out. The briefcase and all the papers were later found by a former armed forces member turned doctor in a supermarket car park, thrown into a skip. Evidently, the thief didn't think they were very valuable. But the laptop was still missing. The British government feared that the laptop could fall into the hands of the Iraqi government, or that it was their agents who stole it. If this happened, then the entire plan for the Gulf War would have to be rewritten. Troops redeployed, more money spent, and more chance of the Iraqi military being prepared enough to potentially cause thousands more coalition casualties than expected. If it were a common thief who stole the laptop, the government was worried that they might try and sell it to the Iraqi embassy for a high price. But there was also a chance that the Iraqi regime didn't know, and that the British government still had time to stop them finding out, as well as stop the American government finding out until they had some good news to go with it so as to soften the blow of the bad news. Some of the top military and government officials in the country had rushed and tense meetings as they planned what to do. They put out a D notice on the laptop story. D for defence. This is a non-mandatory request to British news organisations not to publish any stories about an incident because it would be a national security threat. Oftentimes it's also used to hush up stories the government doesn't want people to know about, like in 1967, when the government tried to cover up that the secret services were illegally reading British citizens' private communications with people abroad. At first, there was no public mention from the government about the laptop, just the papers and that they'd been found. The British government got a team of specialists to work out exactly what was on the laptop, so they knew what information might be gotten from it. Farquhar was questioned and said that he had made sure that the actual ground and air campaign plan had been deleted beforehand, and only the deception plan remained. But the specialists weren't convinced that it couldn't still be found in the hard drive. A journalist from The Independent who knew about the story tried to get it published, but his editors were complying with the D notice and refused. Instead, he told a journalist from the Irish Times, which, not being a British newspaper, were not requested to follow the D notice and so released the story. The British commander in Saudi Arabia, Lieutenant General Peter de la Billière, found out on January 2, 1991, from BBC News about the papers, but not about the laptop, and felt that the coalition commander, General Norman Schwarzkopf, had to be told. He would find out anyway, and de la Billière felt it would be better coming from the British military, but feared that all the trust the American government and military had in them would be crushed. Surprisingly, for a man known for violent outbursts, Schwarzkopf was actually pretty relaxed about the whole thing. The same couldn't be said for leading Pentagon officials who reportedly went ballistic. They felt that the British government wasn't telling them the whole story about the theft. At this point, they hadn't said why Farquhar had left them in the car, nor that the laptop was missing, and thought that they were trying to downplay the whole thing by repeating that the papers had been recovered quickly. One Pentagon official was so angry, he said that Farquhar should be shot. A massive search was launched to find the laptop, but couldn't. The Ministry of Defence had come to the conclusion, based on the fact that the briefcase had been thrown in the bin, that the Iraqi government wasn't behind it and that it was just a common thief. But still, they couldn't find him. Then, 3 weeks later, the laptop was sent in the post to a police station by the thief. None of the plans had been lost or tampered with. The plans never got into Iraqi government hands, and their theft had no impact on the war. After the war, Farquhar was court-martialed and found guilty of conduct prejudicial to good order and discipline. The records of the court-martial are closed until 2025, so I don't know exactly what punishment he got, but the maximum sentence he could have been given was being kicked out of the military and 2 years in jail. They might have not gone that far due to his mental state at the time, but I don't know at all what happened to him. When the laptop was sent to the police, there was a note attached from the person who stole it. "Dear Sir, I am a common thief, and I love my queen and country. Whoever lost this should be hung. Yours, Edwards." He did keep the £1,000, though.